Hakuna Matata. What a wonderful phrase. Hakuna Matata.
Okay, that's not fair. The other guy never has to follow that. Gee whiz. Good morning. Welcome to First Parish in Bedford. We are a 287-year-old congregation in a meeting house which this year is celebrating its 200th birthday. Happy birthday. We are a Unitarian Universalist congregation, and that means we are united by our shared moral values of justice, equity, and compassion, rather than by a creed or a dogma. We celebrate the many diversities among us, and we welcome you, whoever you are, no matter which side you are on of the many artificial dividing lines that people have created to separate us into different groups. You are welcome in this church as a human being with no adjectives attached. We are an adjective-free zone. So, welcome. My name is Ron Cortes. I am not a minister. I don't even play one on TV. I'm here because all of our full-time ministers seem to have skipped town. Our senior minister, John Gibbons, is on one of his semi-annual pilgrimages to the birthplace of Unitarianism in Transylvania. Our parish minister, Megan Lyons, is in the middle of a well-earned sabbatical. And our student minister, Josh Leach, is here, but he's got the day off, other than ringing the bell. So you're stuck with me. So I'm not a minister, I'm not even a preacher, I'm more of a storyteller. So what I'm gonna do today is try to tell you a story. And I'm trying to decide whether John asking me to do this service was a statement of great trust or a demonstration of just how desperate he was to fill the pulpit today. So please join us after the service for a social hour, coffee and conversation in the common room, back that-a-way, as well as upstairs in the Blinn room. And if you'd like to learn more about us, please stop at the welcome table, which you'll pass on your way to the common room. You may also fill out one of those little blue cards that are in the back of the pew in front of you, and that will help you keep in touch with us if you're new. There will be a talkback session at 11:30 or so, I am told, for those who haven't had enough of me by then. The talkback will be announced, as usual, by the clanging of that really annoying gong in the common room. It will be in here because the First Parish Gallery will be holding a Bedford Center for the Arts photo group show upstairs, titled Illumination Reflection in the Bacon Room from 11:30 to 1. So we're going to be in here. Which brings me to announcements. Good segue there. I do call your attention to the announcements printed in the back of your order of service, especially to point out at 3 o'clock today, some of the same amazing voices you just heard here are going to be doing the Valentine's Day concert, which was postponed from Valentine's Day because of the snow, to now, hopefully, they'd have nice spring weather. I'm not sure how that's working out, but okay. So today I'm going to talk about some lessons that I learned the hard way 50 years ago and how maybe they can apply to what many of us are going through today. And I can't think of a better way to begin than with the words of that great abolitionist Frederick Douglass. So please join me in reading responsively number 579 in our hymnal, The Limits of Tyrants. Not that I'm making any judgments, you understand. Those who profess to favor freedom and yet deprecate agitation are people who want crops without plowing up the ground. Rain without thunder and lightning. They want the ocean without the awful roar of its waters. This struggle may be a moral one, or it may be both moral and physical, but it must be a struggle. Power concedes nothing without a demand. It never did, and it never will. Find out what people will submit to, and you have found out the exact amount of injustice which will be imposed upon them. The tyrants are prescribed by the endurance of those whom they oppress. And please rise as you're willing and able and say with me our unison affirmation as printed in your order of service. Love is the spirit of this church and service is its law. This is our great covenant, to dwell together in peace, to seek the truth in love, and to help one another. How many of you saw any of the three Lord of the Rings movies when they came out? You remember the story. Frodo, the hero, is on this great quest to do something that is basically undoable, impossible. But because he sticks to it and perseveres, he actually gets it done. Frodo is no different than you or me or anybody else. At the end of the quest, there's a scene that I love where he's talking to Gandalf, the old wizard. And Frodo says to Gandalf, "I wish that this need not have happened in my time." And Gandalf says to him, "So do I, and so do all of us who live in such times." But that is not what we have to decide. The thing that we have to decide is what we will do with the time in which we are given. What will we do with the times in which we are given? So as you go off to your ingathering, think wisely, my young friends, about what you will do with the time that you are given. Professor?
My name is Maria Green, and I'm part of the lay pastoral care team. At this point in our service, we invite anybody who would like to come to the front and light a candle of joy and concern to come up. And I will be at the candle stand after the service if you would like to light a candle privately. And this candle is for all the unspoken joys and concerns in the congregation.
When John Gibbons first asked me to do a service on my experiences in 1968, I have to admit I was quite hesitant. There are some very painful memories buried in here, memories that I have not fully shared with anyone, including myself, for half a century. Memories I really wasn't sure I wanted to unpack. But then I began to realize that the pain I see all around me since the election last November is the same kicked in the stomach feeling that I felt in the aftermath of the 1968 election. And I realized that maybe, just maybe, some of those lessons learned can help me and maybe you get through the next 4 years. So here we go. So what brought me to Chicago? I'm glad you asked. I was born in the city of New Orleans at a very young age. In spite of being raised in the Deep South in the 1940s and 50s, I came by my liberal democratic beliefs honestly. My grandfather Cortez was a union organizer in the 1920s on the New Orleans waterfront. He was a tough old bird, gentle as can be, but a tough old bird. I only saw the old man cry one time in his entire life, April 12, 1945, when he walked into the house and announced, "Franklin Roosevelt died today." My dad spent the war as a shipyard supervisor at the J.C. Higgins Boatyard building PT boats for the U.S. Navy. He proudly claimed that his crew had built PT-109, President Kennedy's boat. After the war, old man Higgins ordered him to report any employees who were engaged in nefarious union organizing activities so he could fire them. My dad promptly resigned. Being a young man with liberal leanings in the Deep South in the 50s and 60s, I did not have a lot of friends with which I could talk politics. I secretly attended a few civil rights rallies here and there, and several campus rallies while LSU was being desegregated in the early 60s, but that's about it. But then in 1966, My best friend from high school went to Vietnam, where he stepped on a landmine and lost both his legs above the knee. Safely back home in a VA hospital, he somehow got his hands on his service pistol and took the only way he could think of out of his pain and his suffering. I found out about his death just days before Dr. Martin Luther King made his famous Beyond Vietnam speech on April 4th, 1967, bizarrely just 1 year to the day before he would be assassinated. In that speech, he said that there's a common link forming between the civil rights movement and the peace movement. I felt like he was speaking directly to me and had given me an outlet for my rage at the unnecessary death of my friend. So I marched and I demonstrated, but it felt hollow. I wasn't actually doing anything to change the nation's reckless course and stop the war that had taken my friend's life. I felt that the country was going to hell in a handbasket and there was nothing I could do about it. Meanwhile, a man named Allard Lowenstein, a veteran political organizer and anti-war activist, was furiously trying to find a candidate to run against Lyndon Johnson in 1968. He offered the job to New York Senator Robert F. Kennedy, who flatly turned him down, saying he would not risk his political career to challenge a sitting president. And then on October 20th, 1967, Senator Eugene McCarthy of Minnesota entered the race as the anti-war candidate. I heard McCarthy's speech on the evening news. I was spellbound. Here at last was something I could do besides sneak off to demonstrations. I could organize and work for a candidate who was actually promising to end the damn war. The next morning, I called Information. Remember them? And asked for the number of the McCarthy for President office. No such listing. In desperation, I called the senator's Senate office in Washington. Hi, can you tell me how to get in touch with the McCarthy for President people? Experience? Well, I've worked in presidential campaigns as far back as Adlai Stevenson in 1952. Okay, that was a tiny fib. But I did help my granddad distribute leaflets for Stevenson that year, so it wasn't an outright lie. Where am I? New Orleans. Yeah, Louisiana. Okay, here's my number. I'll await his call. So an hour or so later, my phone rings, and it's somebody who sounds like he's calling from a phone booth on a busy street. We chatted for a while, and by the end, he agreed that they would send me some seed money to set up an office in New Orleans, which happened. And then on March 12, 1968, Senator McCarthy narrowly lost the New Hampshire primary to Lyndon Johnson. The vote was so close that it shook up the entire race. All of a sudden, everybody realized Lyndon Johnson was vulnerable. 4 days later, Bobby Kennedy, who in September did not have the courage to put his political career on the line by challenging Johnson, got into the race. Many of us felt betrayed and called this an act of political cowardice, sitting safely on the sidelines and letting McCarthy take the political risk, and then when we had proven that Johnson could be beat, jumping into the race. And then, of course, 2 weeks later, President Johnson stunned the nation by announcing that he would not run for re-election. 4 days after that, Dr. King was assassinated. And only 2 months later, Bobby Kennedy was assassinated. We were all shell-shocked. We felt like we'd been kicked in the stomach. Coupled with President Kennedy's assassination 4 years earlier, it seemed the forces of evil had decided to kill all of our good liberal leaders, and there was not a damn thing we could do about it. And you think things are depressing today. Around the end of June, I got a call from Curtis Gans, the McCarthy campaign's political director. It seems there was an African-American organization in Mississippi who were challenging the all-white delegation of Governor Ross Barnett to the Democratic National Convention. Would I be interested in meeting with them and coordinating with them? Senator McCarthy would support their challenge and was hoping they would support his candidacy. I replied I'd be happy to and was told to expect a letter of introduction in the mail. The letter showed up about a week later. It was addressed to one of the founders of the Mississippi Freedom Democratic Party, a woman named Fannie Lou Hamer. The letter introduced me as Senator McCarthy's Louisiana State Coordinator. News to me. And authorized me to negotiate with the MFDP for their support at the convention. Second letter gave me directions for how to contact Ms. Hamer. I met Fannie Lou Hamer at an all-black roadside diner in the utter boondocks of Mississippi early one afternoon. I may well have been the first white person ever to set foot in the place. When I drove up, I was admonished to park my car around behind the diner where it could not be seen from the highway. That was the first red flag. We sat at a single table in a curtained-off part of the restaurant. The only other person I saw was the owner who brought us our food. Ms. Hamer agreed that she would happily support Senator McCarthy, and I assured her that her group would have our full support in their credentials challenge. I left the meeting absolutely mesmerized. Fannie Lou Hamer remains one of the most amazing human beings I have ever met. She dazzled me, not only with her presence, but with her knowledge of Mississippi state politics and with the extraordinary means her organization had to go through to stay one step ahead of not only the state authorities, but the Ku Klux Klan as well. This was not just a political game. This was life or death. I have to admit, I kept looking in my rearview mirror all the way home that evening, being very careful to stay within the posted speed limit. The next day, I called Curtis Gans and told him that Ms. Hamer was on board. He was thrilled and said that he wanted me to come to Chicago as a member of the senator's national campaign staff so I could continue to work with the challenge delegation. I asked my boss for 3 weeks vacation, and he said, sure, go lay on a beach somewhere. My beach would be on the shores of Lake Michigan. Let's sing my favorite hymn, number 121, We'll Build a Land.
Thank you.
today being the first Sunday in March, even though it feels like the first Sunday in January, we split the undesignated portion of today's offering with our Unitarian partners in India, the Margaret Barr School in the Khasi Hills. You know, I've always felt that it says a lot about what a congregation thinks about their preacher, whether they collect the offering before or after the sermon. For the good works of this church, both within these walls and far beyond, our offering will now be greatly received before the sermon. I arrived in Chicago a week before the convention began, on the very day that Soviet tanks rolled into Czechoslovakia to crush the so-called Prague Spring Movement. My first job was to attend the hearings of the Credentials Committee to support the Ms. Hamer's group. Governor Ross Barnett was his own worst enemy. red in the face, he berated the Racially Mixed Credentials Committee for even considering those people as the legal delegation from the sovereign state of Mississippi. When it was her turn, Fannie Lou Hamer rose and said very simply, "Governor Barnett has disqualified himself by publicly supporting the Republican nominee, Barry Goldwater, against Lyndon Johnson in 1964, and she sat down. Well, that was all the committee needed to hear, end of story. We had our delegates, and Ross Barnett packed his bags and went home to join the Republican Party. Chicago would be the last time I ever saw Fannie Lou Hamer. She died in 1977. She even wrote her own epitaph. "I am sick and tired of being sick and tired." By now, Vice President Humphrey had entered the race. With Lyndon Johnson's political muscle behind him, he was quietly assembling a vast majority of what we today call superdelegates without ever running in a single state primary. George McGovern had also entered the race and was trying to rally the Kennedy delegates to his cause. I was working the convention floor trying to persuade uncommitted delegates and a few committed ones to support Senator McCarthy, saying that if we split the anti-war vote, we can't possibly win the nomination. But the handwriting was on the wall. Okay, so Senator McCarthy's headquarters were on the 15th floor of the Conrad Hilton Hotel right across Michigan Avenue from Grant Park. For some reason, all the network TV cameras had set up right in front of the hotel, which, of course, attracted all the demonstrators. I had a room on the 15th floor, as did the senator and his entire national campaign staff. Now, see if you can get this picture in your mind. The hotel elevators on the 15th floor opened onto a foyer that was maybe half the size of this room. The wall facing Grant Park was all windows. There were some nice couches and a very large, for those days, TV set. On the night before the convention was to nominate a president, Senator McCarthy called his entire staff together in that foyer. He read us a poem he had written. He was quite the poet. He told us that we would not win the nomination the next night. He told us how proud he was of all of us for having tried. He told us that we had fought the good fight, but that sometimes good does not always prevail. Over in the corner, the TV set was on, showing the first film smuggled out of Czechoslovakia of the Soviet tanks rolling into Prague a week earlier. The parallel was overwhelming. The whole world seemed to be caught up in bending that arc of the moral universe that Theodore Parker mentions in The Thought to Ponder Today, away from justice. Sometimes good does not always prevail. That evening, I and several of my fellow staff members wandered out of the hotel, through the police lines, and into Grant Park, where thousands of demonstrators were peacefully gathered to hear Mary Travers and Peter Yarrow, Peter, Paul, and Mary. I have been told that somewhere in that crowd that evening was a teenage boy named John Gibbons. The next day, I was on the floor of the amphitheater as the vote for president took place. Senator Abraham Ribicoff of Connecticut nominated George McGovern. In his speech, he denounced, quote, "the Gestapo tactics on the streets of Chicago." Mayor Daley, who was front and center with the Illinois delegation, went berserk. He launched into an extended obscenity-laced rant on camera, no sound. At one point, he pointed his finger up at Ribicoff on the podium and screamed, "I'll get you for this, you son of a." When the convention adjourned after nominating Humphrey, I joined many of the anti-war delegates in marching from the amphitheater over to Grant Park to join the thousands of peaceful demonstrators still gathered there. When we got there, things were anything but peaceful. The Chicago police had been ordered to clear the streets, most likely by Mayor Daley, in response to Senator Ribicoff's comment. Police were tear gassing and indiscriminately beating demonstrators. I'm sure you've all seen the TV footage where the demonstrators are chanting, "The whole world is watching. The whole world is watching." This is what the whole world were watching. My group of delegates was forcibly pushed off Michigan Avenue by baton-wielding police. Most of the delegates left to go to their hotels. I went up to the 15th floor. Several of my fellow staffers had set up a makeshift infirmary in the foyer and were treating demonstrators who had been beaten by the police and just left where they fell. All the McCarthy staff members had ID badges. I saved mine. One by one, we would put somebody else's badge in our pocket, and flourishing our own badge, would walk through the police lines into Grant Park. We'd find a wounded protester who somewhat physically matched the photo on the badge. We'd pin the extra badge on them and help them walk through the police lines and into the Hilton. I made the trip 3 or 4 times that night without incident. Shortly before dawn, I was standing by the windows of the 15th floor taking pictures of the goings-on below when I heard a loud commotion behind me. The elevator doors had burst open, and about half a dozen Chicago cops in full riot gear had stormed into the foyer in the hotel, billy clubs in hand. I think there were maybe a dozen patched-up protesters still in there and 5 or 6 attendants. One of the nurses approached one of the policemen, her arms stretched out before her. I could not hear what she said, but without warning, the officer swung his club and hit her right in the head and knocked her to the floor. As he stood over her, I could plainly hear his voice. "We left them in the gutter where they belong, and that's where we want them to stay. You had no right to bring them up here." The other adults rushed forward to their fallen comrade and were treated to a hail of nightsticks. Like an idiot, I raised my camera and started taking pictures. I awoke in a jail cell with my comrades. My right wrist was broken. I had a bloody gash on the side of my head and a splitting headache. The half dozen other McCarthy staffers in the cell with me were in a similar condition. Hours later, Senator McCarthy appeared outside the cell. He had negotiated our release on condition that we leave Chicago and not return. He had a van outside and took us to the airport, where, along with most of his campaign staff, we boarded his chartered flight back to Washington. Sometimes good does not always prevail. Sometimes you get kicked in the stomach or hit over the head. So what did I learn from 1968 that might help us today? In 1968, we all thought we could end the war in Vietnam through political action alone. Boy, were we ever wrong. The intransigence of the Democratic Party establishment thwarted our people's crusade, and the pro-military alignment of the Republican Party under President Nixon prolonged the war for another 7 years and 21,000 more American deaths, plus God alone knows how many Vietnamese deaths. Too many of us dropped out after that, not just out of the anti-war effort, but in some cases out of mainstream society altogether. Those who were left were badly fragmented. Some stayed in the anti-war movement, others turned back to the civil rights movement. Others moved on into the women's movement and the gay rights movement. All were effective in their own little niches, but there was no organized progressive opposition that had the critical mass to change the country's course. And so here we are today, half a century later. Over the last 50 years, the anti-progressive forces have only grown stronger and better organized. There is a part of me that sees a future as bleak as the one I saw after Chicago. Looking ahead to the next 4 years or 8 years of Supreme Court stacking, voter suppression, and the gerrymandering of both state legislative and congressional districts, there is a part of me that fears we may never get our country back, at least not in my lifetime. But there's another part of me that recognizes the mistakes we made after 68 and believes that if we can learn from those mistakes, we don't have to repeat deja vu all over again. Dr. Martin Luther King condensed Theodore Parker's 1853 quote into the famous line, "The arc of the moral universe is long, but it bends toward justice." It was our own Reverend Jack Mendelsohn who commented that the arc does not bend by itself. Human hands must keep on shaping it. So how do we keep on bending that arc towards justice? What do we need to do differently now than we did in 68? Barry Goldwater, of all people, said it best in his made-up fake Latin, illegitimus non carborundum. Don't let the bastards grind you down. Don't drop out. Don't throw up your hands in resignation and let the illegitimati win by default. There are decisions you can make in your daily life that will have a major effect on the direction this country takes. Get involved in politics. You knew I'd get there eventually, didn't you? Run for office if you can. We need to build a stronger bench, local office. If you're a woman who might be interested in running for political office, there is an amazing local group called Emerge, whose main function is to prepare women to run for office. It provides them with training, valuable resources, and an amazing peer support network. Margot Fleischman is an Emerge alumna. Talk to her. Margot is right here. Hi, Margot. Support candidates who support your moral values, not your political values, your moral values. As my Sicilian grandfather used to say, cash is always in good taste. Get involved in their campaigns. Volunteer. Knock on doors. Make phone calls. You can make calls for candidates in other states, too, without ever leaving your own home. Is that not your thing? Ask Alan McRobert. I saw Alan. Where's Alan? There he is. Hi, Alan. It wasn't his thing either, but he tried it, and guess what? He's pretty darn good at it, and he's come to enjoy the experience. Do I lie? If you're not registered in one of the two major political parties, please do so. Now, registering as unenrolled or independent or in one of the fringe parties like the Greens or the Libertarians is frankly a cop-out and a royal waste of your franchise. I'm not sure I could say that any plainer and not use language that can't be on TV. There are only two political parties that can have any effect on the American government for the foreseeable future. Choose one. Make a commitment, and then get to work within that party to move it in the direction in which you would like to see it move. This is barely important, barely less important than your own heartbeat, in my humble opinion. But politics is necessary, but not sufficient. Let me say that again. Politics is necessary, but not sufficient. There are many things outside of politics you can do to ensure that that arc bends farther toward justice. Many of you are already involved in one progressive cause or another. To you I say, keep on keeping on. But do not keep on keeping on in isolation like many of us did after 68. Don't get caught in the trap of saying, my progressive cause is the most important one. And if you don't believe that, if you don't recognize that, then you and I have nothing in common. Down that path lies division, defeat, and the continued victory of the illegitimate. It is vital, it is crucial, that you drive your progressive cause to reach out to other progressive causes and make common cause with them. Use online tools like Indivisible to find local meetups or to announce one of your own. Build grassroots umbrella organizations and join together with the various progressive causes that we all support. We are, as someone recently said, stronger together. And along the way, march and work and demonstrate. But please, and if you take one thing away from today, please take this away. It is the most important thing. Take care of yourself first. Yes, we need you to march and work and demonstrate now, but we will need you even more during next year's election cycle and during the presidential election cycle that's only 3 years away. Don't overdo it now and burn yourself out. If you get stressed out at the news, turn it off. It's okay. The world will not stop turning if you don't watch every news show every day. Take what's coming out of Washington right now with a grain of salt, a very large grain of salt. The president's political advisor has stated in the past that his favorite tactic is to bombard the public with so many things all at once that people overload and quit paying attention, which is exactly what he's trying to do. His goal is to make you overlook the one thing buried in all that avalanche of you know what that he really intends doing and that he doesn't want you to recognize. Take care of yourself. Don't react to everything that comes your way. You have limited resources, people. Ration them wisely. As Gandalf cautioned Frodo, all we have to decide is what to do with the time that is given to us. We are stronger together, and together, only together, each and every one of us together, we can take our country back. Somebody say amen.
Amen.
One more song, number 119. Once to every soul and nation comes a moment to decide.
Thank you.
Have courage, my friends. Believe in yourselves. Have faith in the innate goodness of your fellow citizens. Remember, nothing moves in a straight line. This is a bump in the road. It may be a big bump. It may even turn the car over. But this is a tough old car. It has survived far worse, twice. We will come out the other end. Stay true to your values. Stay true to each other. And keep on keeping on bending that arc towards justice. Go in peace and give them hell.